close the open forum, and then we'll call the meeting to order. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, the roll call this evening, all members are present.
With the agenda, I'd like to amend the agenda tonight on the new business to move item D, which is the curriculum course description, to move it into item B due to a illness and somebody subbing in for them.
Okay, do I have a motion? Do I have a second?
So moved.
By Ben. Second by Melissa. Okay, all those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? That passes 7-0. So we have an amended agenda. Next up is the truth and taxation portion of the meeting. We'll have the proposed 2016 payable 2017 levy certification by Ms. Sink, and then there'll be an opportunity for the public to make comment after that.
Good evening, board members, Chair Ruel, Dr. Sallow. Tonight's the required truth and taxation hearing that the district is required to have as part of the levy certification process. On our agenda tonight are tax levy calendar, basic school funding, factors contributing to our levy change, our 15 or 16 pay 17 levy certification, and there's also some graphical analysis in the PowerPoint tonight. So our authority for school levies, our school district is a little bit different. I've said this for many years now, that our district is different from the counties and the cities, as many of our levies are required by state law or they're voter approved. The board has some discretion for certain areas of levies, but not as much as the cities and the counties. So a school district tax levy must be either set by the state formula or voter approved. So our basic formula for calculating our state aid is taking our authorized total revenue minus our property taxes, and the remainder is state aid. Some factors that are impacting the tax change. Our change in our levies are determined by state formula. The change in the sales ratio, which adjusts impact our adjusted net tax capacity. Any laws that are changed that mandate code compliance, and the latest one that we've had is our long-term facility maintenance. And then issues determined by district voters. Any votes that are approved for a bond referendum or an excess levy referendum affects our levy. And then the local factors, and with these are the areas, pressures on the real estate market, any abatements that we may have, property improvements not previously taxed. So if you have a new home, usually you get a year reprieve and then those taxes come into play. So that would be a property not previously taxed. Change in the individual assessed market value or possible change in classification. So what's included in our district levy certification? Our levies and bonds for our voter approved referendums. There are several levies that are set by state formula, and I'll go through these as part of this process. Equity, and that equity is financial equity. It's not student equity. Operating capital, transition, community service, and our long-term facility maintenance. And then based on local need, reemployment, safe schools. Safe schools is, you know, our school resource officer, that those types of things are paid from there. Career and technical, our facility leases, integration, QComp, and OPEB, other post-employment benefits. So for this levy certification, our adjusted net tax capacity has increased 3.7%, and our referendum market value has increased almost 7%. And it's important to know that, because as we have growth in this community, our taxes are spread across more homes and more properties. So it should see an impact on everyone's taxes, a lower impact. An increase in pupil units, which we have had, and we've also refinanced some existing bonds. And we've reinstated our other post-employment benefit levy for this year. We did exclude it last year, but we reinstated it for $353,000. So our referendum market value analysis, you can see that in 2015, the latest information that we have, that our referendum market value is the highest it has been. The latest, it's back up past where it was in the height of the last economy boom, which was in 2008. And then an adjusted net tax capacity as well has rebounded to those same numbers that we had back in the mid-2000s. Our enrollment history trend, and you can see that we are showing a much higher enrollment this year. Our enrollment hovers around 8,300, somewhere between that. Every day is a little bit different, so but we are still very stable in that number. You can see that we have grown significantly over the past several years and outpacing our trend at this point. So talking about our 16 Pay 17 preliminary levy certification, and this is where we can get into quite a bit of detailed information. We went through this as a part of our preliminary levy. Our local optional is $424 per pupil unit. You can see that's gone up, and it's simply because we have more students in our district. Our equity levy, and this is where I said that this is our equity levy is determined by our financial equity compared to other metro school districts. And because we're on the low end of that, we receive a little bit more money in that area. We're in the lowest. The average referendum is $776, and we're at almost $674. So because there is that difference, we get some additional dollars based on that, because we're in the lowest 25% of districts in the metro that have with that amount of levy referendum. And then transition levy, that's when we have legislation that changes and we lose money, so that money is, whatever we lose is grandfathered back to the district, so that's a small amount of money. Operating capital levy, that's for running our buildings. We also receive aid for that. Long-term facilities maintenance, this is our latest, latest legislative action that was for school districts to be able to take care of their deferred maintenance items in their district. Our district in the past did not have an opportunity to take care of their deferred maintenance because we didn't have a funding source for that besides going to our taxpayers and asking for that money, or like we did in previously refinancing some of our bonds and making some space available in our levy for those types of things. Levy referendums, this is that 673 I was talking about, and you would expect that that amount would go up because we have more students, but it hasn't gone up, and the reason for that is because we're getting a little bit more aid because it's equalized. And when I say it's equalized, I mean that we receive about the first $300 of that $673, the state pays about 40%. It does pay 40% of that, and we pay 60. And then the remaining $373, the district pays all of that, or the local taxpayers pays all of that. So there's actually three tiers, and we only hit the first two. The first tier, like I said, is $300. The next tier is $760. So we would have to get over $1,060 in local operating referendum in order to hit that next tier. We have student achievement levy. That's gone down a little bit just due to calculations. Our QCOMP is about stable in that area. That's based on the number of teaching staff that we have. Our reemployment levy is a little bit less, simply because economies is better and we have more people working. Our state schools levy, that is what we utilize for our school resource officers and for surveillance cameras and those types of things. Career and technical, That's for a certain career path, money that we receive. It's a small amount, $90,000. Health and safety, you can see that's a negative amount, and that's some adjustments. That is going away, health and safety, and it's being replaced by that long-term facilities maintenance. So you will see that eventually balance out to a zero amount in our fund balance as part of that. Lease facilities, we lease some of our facilities for our ALC, the addition at the high school, turf, those specific spaces, and that's the amount that we pay on an annual basis for those facilities. We can lease $212 per pupil unit, and as we grow, that number will increase, but that's the amount of money that we have for lease facilities. Achievement and integration, you can see that that's gone down quite a bit. We levied a little bit, thinking last year that we were going to utilize some more money in integration, and we did not. So you're seeing an adjustment to our levy certification. Our OPEB, you can see last year we did not levy for that, and this year we are, and that's based on the prior year's actual costs for those benefits. We have a negative adjustment facilities and equipment bond, and that's because that money now shows up in our debt service fund as a positive, so they offset each other, and then we have a small amount of prior year adjustments. So you can see in the general fund, we have a 0.77% increase in our levy certification. For community service, and I want to point out, I have a column here for the 2017 preliminary, and it did adjust down slightly. In our community service fund, you can see it went down a little bit. And in our debt service, that is the same amount for our building bonds. That is our annual payment for our principal and interest for those bonds that we have. The long-term facilities debt, that money is what is part of our general fund that we are not using in the general fund. It gets shifted here as well. So that is a total amount. And then so between all of our funds, we're seeing a 2.86% increase overall for the district. You can see how it's split out. 60% is voter approved, 23% is our state determined, and then 17% is our local discretion. If you want to look at our 7-year levy history, you can see over several years, it's only been in the last 2 years that we've had, or 3 years that we've had any significant increases. This year it's 2.86, last year was 4.70, and the previous year was 1.6. And besides that, we've been pretty flat. So over the years, it's been very minor increases. Some information that I also presented at the preliminary levy is that we have 22,263 residential homes in the district. For 214 additional homes over the prior year, our average home value and our median home value, $310,000 and $281,000, respectively. 16% of our homes in the district have increased in value over 5%, and only those homes that have increased in value over 5% may possibly see an increase in their school taxes. It really just depends on how evaluations across the board are implemented. All others would remain the same or decrease. And I did this little exercise previously as well, looking at how our adjusted net tax capacity and the market value really play a big role in how those taxes are spread across homes. And if you can see property one, I tried to have values that range anywhere from $100,000 home up to a $2.2 million home. And so it really just depends on the value of that home and what's happened across the years that they may have seen an increase or in decrease in their taxes. So if you look at 2012, where we had a negative 0.2% decrease, still some people, I should really look at 2013, some people still had an increase just because their value of their home increased. Or we may have an increase and people saw a decrease because the valuation across the district increased. So it really does depend on so much on what the valuation of property is across our district. And then one of the things that we need to talk about is our budget, which is proposed at this point, and later on in tonight's meeting that we will go through the budget. But you can see that we are looking at a pretty balanced budget for this year for our general fund. This is a current year budget. We have not set the 2017-18 budget yet. And again, it's a little bit different. Most cities and counties will be talking about their next year budget. We're not quite there yet because we're just in the middle of our fiscal year. And then again, our food service, community ed, and our building funds all are listed here as well. And any questions?
Questions? All right, this is our second time seeing this through. So we did have some discussion at study session about this. Okay. We have to approve, correct?
No, you don't need to
approve.
Do anything
just
now.
Proposed.
This is just
okay.
A truth and taxation
okay.
Hearing, and this would be a time that...
Then later on we're doing. Okay. All right, so if there's anyone in the public that would like to comment on the levy certification, the proposed levy certification. Okay, seeing none. All right. Move on to the consent agenda. The consent agenda items are considered routine in nature and will be enacted in one motion. Tonight we have the check wire transfer disbursement summary, the bank reconciliation statement from September 2016 and October 2016, approval of the school board minutes of November 14, the canvassing of election results, November 14, the regular board meeting, November 28, the board work study sessions, resignations, terminations, non-renewals as listed, as well as the 2017 organizational chart. Do I have a motion to accept the consent agenda?
So moved.
By Dan, second.
Second.
By Chad. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? That passes 7-0. And next up is gifts. The resolution for the gifts are listed in your board packet, whereas the following members have generously offered to donate to Prior Lake Savage Area Schools. Do I have a motion to accept the resolutions for gifts?
So moved.
By Todd, second.
I will second Todd's motion.
By Rich. This is a roll call vote. Chad?
Aye.
Ben?
Aye.
Dan?
Aye.
Todd?
Aye.
Aye. Rich?
Aye.
Melissa?
Aye.
That passes 7-0. Okay, and next up is Laker Pride. We have some representatives from the Minnewaukan Sioux this evening. Want to come up?
Good evening, everyone. This is always one of our favorite times of our board meetings. One of our core values in Prior Lake Savage Area Schools is partnerships. And tonight, I believe we have two representatives. One representative, but I see two back there from the Shakopee-Minnewaukitan Sioux community. Vice Chair Keith Anderson, if you would please come up. And just so it's duly noted, Chairman Charlie Vig is also in the back. Tonight, we are humbled to accept an amazing grant from the SMSE community, $125,000 to our school district. $25,000 of that will go into our American Indian education. And the other $100,000, I can't tell you exactly what we're doing yet, but we are making sure that we align those funds with our eSTEM efforts, and our hope is that that will also be something that honors the culture of the tribe that's been such a wonderful partner with us. So thank you very much for the very generous donation, and I'd love if you'd say a few words.
Sure. Thank you very much. I think she took care of most of most of the words that I thought I was going to say, but I'm sure that the donation that you what you decide to do with it will honor. And I'd like to just address the board, and if this is the newly seated board, congratulations to the newly elected or the incumbent reelected, and if not, thank you all for your service. So I know we appreciate it, and one of the reasons for the donation would be that you know, we appreciate and recognize all that you do for the school district and our community youth. And it was probably a consensus of our, it's hard to explain. We have some work groups that work on a lot of things, and donations is one of them. And as we get towards the end of the year, we start to consolidate the grants that haven't occurred or the money that might be left over, and we try to find something locally that we can support. And I'm surprised we haven't done it more in the past. But with this, we've also donated $125,000 to Shakopee as well. So that's all I can think of. So I really appreciate Lake of Pride, though, having us up here. Thank you very much. Back there, you notice they cut the mic off because they knew I was going to come on. I don't carry $100,000 with me, but he does. I'm just kidding.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Oh, thank you very much. Thank you. This is great. This will look great. We'll pass that along, and I'll pass your words along. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. We also are delighted to have another community partner group join us tonight and share a little bit about their donation to our special education department. So right now I'd like to ask the representatives from the Chase Warrior Foundation to please come forward. I'm going to let the representatives introduce themselves. Tell us a little bit about the foundation, and I know we're accepting a very generous gift on behalf of this foundation as well. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Chris Licken, and I am the co-president. My wife, Lisa, is also a president of Chase's Warrior Foundation. We started this a year ago, July, in honor of my son, who's now 8. 4 years ago, he had a near drowning accident. And, you know, thanks to the grace of God, he's here. But throughout the process, he had an anoxic brain injury. And we learned a lot about the difficulties of trying to go back to the way things were when you don't have that stuff. And so these are actually, the rest of the board members are friends of ours that helped us out through this process. We got together and said, you know, we wanted to give a few things away because they saw how we struggled, and actually the community was very generous to my wife and I, our family, and, you know, fortunately I was in a position that I didn't need help anymore, so we decided that we would get together with friends, and we started a foundation to give back to a lot of people out there that don't have the stuff that we have. So that's where Chase's Warrior Foundation began, and we started initially to just kind of serve the general public and help them out, but we were privileged enough to attend Red Tail Ridge, which is probably one of the best schools, definitely in this end of the state, and as far as I'm concerned, for special ed. You know, Barb and all the girls are doing an incredible job. So we worked with them a little bit, met some parents, and gave a few things away. And then we actually approached the very generous Manawatan Sioux for a grant for Shakopee and Prior Lake school districts. And they were very generous and accepted gave us a matching grant, which we are fortunate to be able to give you guys, you know, a portion of that. A portion is going to go to Shakopee. But I do want to note that the rest of this money came from the community. We did a car wash, and members of the community donated. We just had a lot of people, checks pouring in from people that really care about our kids in this district and in the Shakopee district. We live in an amazing community, and we are all very thankful to be here. And I'll pass it to the board, and they can just say their name. And
Lisa Licken.
Brian Hennen.
Jeremy Drentlaw.
Amy Hennen.
Anita Drentlaw.
Anna Stein.
Dan Stein.
We have a check here in the amount of $10,000, which was part of the matching grant to go towards special education in District 719. I know you guys will do well with it. Yeah, you bet.
Thank you both so much. Our students benefit greatly from our community partnerships, and tonight is an amazing example of that. Our students also benefit greatly from the impact of our school board members. And I know at times it is a thankless job. And I know since I've been here, the hours and hours and hours that the individuals behind me have spent making really difficult and really great decisions on behalf of our students is something that I can't say enough about. And tonight, we have two board members who are retiring and will no longer be with us. And I want to be sure tonight that we have a chance to recognize and to thank them. So Chad Rittenauer, if you would please come up here, and Dan White, please come up here. Chad has served on the board for the last 4 years. His questions and his input are always welcome. He's got children in the district, so he brought a great life and energy to our conversations around that. So Chad, thank you very much. And I'd also like to thank Dan White. Dan is completing 15 and a half years of service, 16 and a half years of service, thank you, Ben, to Prior Lake Savage Area Schools. And if you think about the number of Monday nights for both gentlemen, the number of Monday nights, and then the extra meetings that get called, and the committee meetings that get called, and the activities and students, sporting events that our board members attend to show their support of our robotics and our music and our band and our academics and all of our programs. It's amazing. So for all of your years of service, for your continued support to our school district and our students, thank you, Dan. Both of you would like to say a few words. Certainly.
I question whether or not I should do this, but I'm going to anyway. And I was going to save it to the end, but now is as good time as any. I just want to thank the community for all the kind words, especially since the election. And this is my second goodbye that I've had with the district. And I want to thank the current board members for doing a number of things, challenging me, questioning me, supporting me, doing everything they can to make the right decision for our kids. And it has been an absolute honor to serve with all of you. And Terry, I've had a chance to serve with four superintendents, and I have to say I'm gonna miss our monthly chat. I'm going to miss popping in just to see how things are going. And even though we step away tonight, I step away knowing that the district is in very good hands. And we'll miss working with you, but I wish all you guys the best in whatever the future might hold. Thank you.
Next up is personnel items.
All right. Good evening, members of the board and Dr. Stallo. First off, I recommend the following candidates for employment and am seeking board approval.
Okay. Do I have a motion for the candidates for employment?
So moved.
By Dan, second?
Second.
by Chad. All those in favor say aye.
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 That passes 7-0.
And next up, I present the following leaves of absence and I'm seeking board approval.
Okay, do I have a motion to accept the leaves of absence as listed?
I'll move.
By Ben, second by Chad. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? That passes 7-0.
And next up, we have two job descriptions. So I'm presenting the following job descriptions. They represent title changes, and there are no other material changes to those job descriptions.
All right. Do I have a motion to accept the revised job descriptions as listed?
So moved.
By Dan, second?
Second.
By Ben. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? That passes 7-0.
And I have two staffing requests this evening. First up is a license staffing request. We have identified additional students throughout the course of the school year here in early childhood special education, and we are requesting an additional 0.5 FTE in that program as a result.
All right, do I have a motion to approve the additional staffing in license 2016-17?
I will make that motion.
Rich, second?
Second.
By Todd. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? That passes 7-0.
And then next up is a staffing request for educational support staff. This comes at Grainwood, Redtail Ridge, Jeffers Pond, and Edgewood. All four of these positions, two of them represent new positions, two of them represent an increase in hours. All are driven by identified student needs in IEPs.
All right. Do I have a motion to accept the additional staffing for ESS?
So moved.
By Chad, second?
Second.
By Dan, all those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? That passes 7-0. That's it. Okay. Next up is short-term facilities options, which we have been discussing for really the last couple months, and we've sought community input in that last study session, having a listening session, and we do have the administration recommendation upon us tonight. And upon further analysis, I guess, and review on my part, and I've just kind of been struggling with this decision, as I think many of us have been, I wanted to go over these recommendations. I think if we look at the recommendations that's in your board packet, B, C, D, E, and F, I think A is where we're landing on, and I myself personally want to make a motion to accept these and expand on them a little bit, and I want to do it so that we can get the conversation going, basically. So I'd like to limit open enrollment to 1% at grade levels K through 12 for next year, including kindergarten, as well as the current school year going to the 1% as well for the current school year. So I'm going to make a motion for that. I'm looking for a second.
Second.
Okay, there's a motion and a second. And then we'll have some discussion. So I wanted to discuss and see where people are at with that, and talk about the ramifications and implementation. Sorry, I can't say I can't say it right now. I'm at bad cold. You know what I'm saying. And so, you know, I think there's financial, there's teaching, you know, teaching staff positions. There's lots of implications to do that. So maybe with that, I maybe would turn it over to Jeff, or just if we have any questions, or Matt or Julie, if you guys, can we talk about some of the financial implications of that, making that type of decision?
There will be financial implications. One of the things that we had talked about by leaving kindergarten open was that we would maintain that number of students in open enrollment. Wouldn't necessarily grow If we kept it at the number, you know, leaving open enrollment at the kindergarten level open. However, if that happens and you decide that that's your choice is to close that, it's just going, it will be offset by any increases in in resident enrollment. This year, if we were to do that this year, we would have done that this year. We would have lost about 150 students in open enrollment. We had 105 kindergarten open enrolled students, but we actually have a net decrease in grades 1 through 12 of 47 students. So, you know, we're about 150 students if we allow the 1% at kindergarten. So if you take that number and then what offset by, you know, it would need to be offset by resident enrollment, which we've had this year. So I just want the board to understand.
So per pupil, I mean, what do we get per pupil? I mean, just roughly, I mean.
Well, the state aid, the basic state revenue is a little over $6,000, but we also lose.
Right.
Other categorical.
Other dollars, okay.
So you're looking like $7,000 a student.
Okay. Matt, how about staffing-wise?
Yeah, and with staffing, it's very similar. I think we've kind of run through the scenarios at the study sessions when we've been able to have the conversation. And, you know, as I'm looking forward, if we're assuming that we have a similar number of retirements and or resignations at the elementary level that we've typically seen in terms of employee migration, then I would anticipate that we'll be pretty flat there. Would be my best guess at the elementary level. At the middle level, and this really has more to do with student migration than it does open enrollment decisions, you know, we're seeing a fairly significant change in student migration that's outpaced the amount of students enrolling that we've seen over the last couple of years. And so in that area, it's a little less certain that we won't need to see staffing reductions. But again, that has significantly more to do with student migration than it does with enrollment.
Okay. Does anyone else have any questions? Go ahead, Dan.
Sorry. Are you talking about not just for 17-18, but
correct,
closing open enrollment effective immediately,
mm-hmm,
for this school year?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
And I don't think it's closing it. We need to respect the 1%.
So if
there's a grade level, close it to whatever's limited, the lowest limit. Yeah.
So if we have, kindergarten would be closed because we have that. However, second or third grade may not have those seven students yet.
Right.
I think what she's trying to do is limit the influx of people with the notification.
I understand. Yeah. Well, could I?
Yeah, go right now.
I've been as vocal as anybody about trying to give the administration as much flexibility as possible, but when I look back at the trends with kindergarten open enrollment, the numbers have been anywhere from 8 to 10% of our students coming to kindergarten. In the past years, that's been the open enrollment percentage. The last 3 years, it's ticked up to over 20%, and in the current situation that we are in with our lack of space and what we're going to have to go to the public to try to accomplish, I think the only prudent thing to do is to probably close this off at the legal limit.
Grades?
Grades K through 12.
Okay. And go ahead, Rich.
So what would be the limit then on the K for next year?
Six students.
Okay.
Someone asked me what the financial loss would be. Is about a little over $1 million.
Okay. And it's not so much a space concern. I think, how many sections then in the K would we lose from going, let's say, the current 105?
Five.
Approximately five.
Okay.
Somewhere in between 4 and 5.
So these open enrollment students, if we were to keep them, we could put them in any building in the district, right? And we have sufficient
space. Yeah.
I guess my concern is that as we've looked at those migration charts that we all see, that if we cut, this is kind of the foundation of our student population. When they're in at kindergarten, they're here. You know, today's open enrolled student is tomorrow's, you know, resident student. So I'm a little bit concerned with limiting the K. And I guess, and with the loss of those sections and those teachers, I guess I would make, I guess one more question then. Could we limit open enrollment to a number?
Mm-hmm.
For K, like
yes.
75 or 50 or?
Right.
When would that number have to be determined then for staff?
With the recommendation that, that Chair Ruel has put out there, that's the most restrictive.
Yes.
And so as far as the number of setting it at 50, 80, whatever, I, you know, we're hoping to receive direction tonight because we are on the cusp of registration and communications.
Does registration happen before our next board meeting?
It kicks off formally on January 19th, but enrollment packets are available, and we have resident families already filling out those packets, as well as non-resident families who are also filling out those packets in addition to the open enrollment request form.
Todd.
What is the latest date that we can accept a open enroll student or not accept them? Is there a cutoff date by state mandate?
No, the cutoff dates that are listed in statute is if we had something in our achievement integration plan that stipulated students going back and forth between our districts, but since we don't have that, we can set our own dates. So at the previous board work sessions, you may recall that we put a tiered system that we put in there of identifying when we would be letting parents know when they've, you know, been accepted into the district, and then placement coming later this spring or even late spring, depending on how enrollment comes in from our residents.
Ben.
I think I share, I think, both your concerns and sentiments about limiting open enrollment, but also do echo Rich's concerns and the fact of it's a lot of revenue that we're missing. It's a lot of potential teaching jobs that, depending on retirements and resignations, that have yet to be determined, that we're putting at flux, but also reducing open enrollment from 100 kindergarten kids or 150 down to 5 or 6, it doesn't afford us a lot of flexibility, where I would definitely share in a thought of you know, friendly amendment to a number of, you know, whether that whatever that right number is, to be able to allow us to maneuver through better populating and leveling off our buildings and setting the kindergarten classes specifically to a reasonable and manageable level. So it doesn't completely restrict it down to the 1%, but you know, in that 40 to 50 range, I think I'd be accepting of. I mean, I think it's a doesn't get us all the way to the fullest extent of the law, but also it helps us to be able to be a little bit more flexible. I think one of the things I look back at is this has been a struggle for me, having two kids in the district, of you know, why I ran initially, and it was because I saw the growth where I live for Five Hawks, and wanted to be part of these conversations, which I've thrust myself into. And one of the things I've prided myself on is being able to look farther than just what's right here and the strategy that's involved in kind of shaping the overall district and what it looks like 5 and 10 years from now. And I've shared my concerns that I think it's the right thing to do to limit open enrollment for the future. But it's also, it's concerning because I think what we've done in the past has shaped us who we are. But I think in order to take the next step forward to help our district grow, it's the right thing to do from a strategy standpoint and from a shaping standpoint. So.
I think it's the right thing to do to limit to 1% because it's one of the things we can control. I know we're looking at some lost revenue, but we're still growing. We're still having our internal growth, and that's the big number. So we should control what we can control, and that's the influx into kindergarten. And in the future, we'll have a smaller class there, but there's still people coming in at all grades internally to our district, which we will take, so. And one more thing, we should limit it to 1% because that sends the right message out to everybody that we are looking at this right now. And it tells the parents who are outside the district, you know, that they may not get in. And we can always open up later if there is the need.
I agree with your statement there, but I also want to respect the knowledge that the outside people coming into this district are still Lakers and Laker families, and without them, Lago would not have opened. Without them, Sage would not have opened, and without them, Bridges would not have opened. So I think we need to be respectful to them on that portion, but I do think showing the community that we're serious about limiting this to the 1% is the right thing to do now. If we do find out something in the next 2 months, we'll get monthly updates on this. We can always reopen it, and I think the prudent thing is to say, let's look at this right now and then keep looking at it as we have throughout the year. So.
Awesome. What we've heard from Julie and Matt again tonight, I think, is that we've clearly outpaced our trend. The 2014 demographics study shows that we're over by 300 students of what we thought. We saw that tonight on the slide. 1 in 5 students is open enrolled in kindergarten right now. We've heard, I think, resounding from the community that we need to put the highest priority on the students that are here already, because those are students from outside Prior Lake and Savage. We've open enrolled. We want to educate everyone and give them the opportunity for the great programs that we have, but at this time, we need to be very cognizant about the ones that are here already. They're Lakers now, and limit the open enrollment to 1%, including the kindergarten, for 1 year. We can look at it again, but our local taxpayers, they take a precedent because they're funding a good chunk of those students. We've heard that pretty clearly. And our design capacity, we're within 10 students of that, so we are full. We don't have any more room.
Well, I'm just concerned that we're really hitting the brakes hard, and what happens when you hit the brakes hard is your head goes through the windshield. So, and I guess I'd like to amend the motion to state that we close open enrollment to 1% for grades 1 through K, but or 1 through 12, excuse me, and then at the kindergarten have open enrollment to a maximum of 50.
For next year.
For next year.
Anything for this year?
No, we can close the open enrollment for this year.
To the 1%?
To the 1%.
Okay, and there's been an amendment to the motion. Is there a second?
Second.
By Ben. Any discussion on this? Okay, so now this is voting on the amendment.
Correct.
Okay, so I'm a first and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Nay.
That fails 2-5. Okay, so now we go back to the original. Any other discussion on that? Okay. All right, so I'm going to reiterate this, and we're probably going to have to take a recess because I'm going to have to rewrite the resolution. So you know that. And let's just take 1 second, because did anyone have any comments on the B through D or E, whatever, F? Sorry, I lost my screen here. Where is my? B, C, D, E, and F, as listed. Okay. So we'd be limiting open enrollment for the current school year for K through 12 to 1% at all buildings. And then next year for the 2017-18 year, limiting to 1% K grades K through 12 as well. And then B, C, D, E, and F is listed. We have a motion and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That passes 7-0. And then I'm going to ask for a recess. So I make a motion for recess. Do I have a second?
I'll second the motion.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, we're going to take a 5 minute. Okay, I'd like a motion to open the meeting again.
So moved.
By Todd, second.
Second.
By Dan. All those in favor say aye.
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 Aye. Okay. That's right. All right, so now I'm going to read the resolution. Sorry, it's not in here. Resolution relating to open enrollment. Whereas the school board seeks to maintain continuity of programs, curriculum, and services through consistent student enrollment, and whereas the school board recognizes that sufficient student enrollment ensures high-quality course offerings for resident students, as well as students enrolling under the Enrollment Options Program, and whereas the state of Minnesota has established an Enrollment Options Program permitting students to attend non-resident districts, Minnesota Statute 124D03, and whereas the state of Minnesota has also established criteria for school districts to approve or deny open enrollment applications based upon capacity of a program, class, or a school building. Whereas in accordance to Minnesota Statute 124D03, Subdivision 2, a board may, by resolution, limit the enrollment for non-resident pupils in its schools or programs according to this section to a number not less than the lesser of 1% of the total enrollment at each grade level in the district. Be it resolved that open enrollment guidelines are as follows. Limit open enrollment at grades K through 12 for 2016-17 to 1% of the total enrollment at each grade level in the district effective immediately. Limit open enrollment at grades K through 12 for the 2017-2018 to 1% of the total enrollment at each grade level in the district. All right, do I have a motion to accept?
So moved.
Okay. By Chad. Second?
Second.
By Todd. This is a roll call vote. Chad?
Aye.
Ben?
Aye.
Dan?
Aye.
Todd?
Aye.
Aye. Rich?
Aye.
Melissa?
Aye.
That passes 7-0. All right. Next up is follow-up requests.
There was a request for some additional information regarding a financial estimate and some planning components for portable classrooms. And so in your board packet is a memo that outlines very conceptually costs associated with a two-classroom structure. You can see the costs that are outlined there. Some of these costs, again, will fluctuate based on construction season, timing, things like that. But we did work with our district consultants to pull these numbers together, as well as our city officials regarding building permits and some of the timelines associated with this request. So again, we share this with you as that was a request at our last work session, as well as to give you this information so that you have some time to look at it and consider it. And then again, it's conceptual, and as it identifies and outlines in the memo, pending any action moving forward, you know, we would request that in order to really finalize this, we would get some formal quotes and timelines associated with the request, ask, and things like that. So, and that's consistent with all of the projects that we do anyways. So,
okay.
With that, questions?
Questions?
From?
Yeah.
Oh, go ahead, Ben.
Go ahead, Ben. Oh, go ahead, Ben. Yeah.
From a timeline standpoint,
timeline standpoint, I know that we had talked about, there's concern about how quickly can this be done. Is there a loose thought as far, I shouldn't say loose, but an approximation of when, what the earliest date would be if this was something that we wanted to move forward with?
Well, if we had everything in place, it would be, the minimum is 40 days to get through the city planning process. We have to obtain a conditional use permit, and that timeline is 40 days.
Okay, is that the longest lead time of all of this then? I mean,
No. We have some challenges on construction. Obviously, we took some liberties on placement. That would still yet to be decided. If we did get them, where would they go?
I think our best estimate right now would be early spring.
Yep.
If there was action moving forward on portables, it would be early spring.
Okay. And the 432, 751 is an annual cost for two classrooms?
No. So some of those are, as you break this down, some of these are one-time costs.
Okay.
If you look at the top one here, the annual rental is $21,600
okay.
of that $43,310. And of course, then there's operating costs and utilities, but it'd be similar to even a existing structure. So, but yeah, there would be annual costs and annual rent
okay.
for that, for this two classroom structure. If it was a four classroom structure, it'd be, double.
Okay.
So, the other component there too, that 432 does include that walking or walkway, component. And there's just a note there too. We do currently have students at the middle schools and between Edgewood and Westwood that do walk outside to access multiple sites. But again, we thought in the interest of having the full scope of what this project could look like, that cost is in there. And that 432 includes that walkway cost.
Yep. Thank you.
Any other questions?
One quick one.
Yeah.
What's the size of the classrooms and the square footage? You have here two classrooms.
Yeah,
they would
smaller.
They would be approximately, I think, 750 to 800 square right. feet.
Each. For each?
Each, yeah.
And monies would come from? General operating?
They would have to come from general operating for this year and next year.
What, in, say, then year three, what could we could levy for only operating at that time?
We would only be able to levy for the $21,000.
And
yeah.
Technology, the $50,000, is that just general price for a classroom? Because I would think it would be less if it's a music classroom, or was that?
We factored in infrastructure. We also factored in, too, if it was, like, regular classrooms. If it was, like, a fifth-grade classroom, fourth-grade classroom. So we factored in a mobile solution. Again, depending on what that facility would look like, that cost may adjust a bit. Again, therein lies, if it's a regular classroom, you have kids that are going from a classroom outside to the main building maybe once or twice a day, whereas if you have art or music out there, you got kids constantly going out at every transition. The other thing we identified too is, and granted, this would be a portable, it would be separate from the rest of the building. If you have a music class out there, these are not soundproof walls. So again, whichever activity would be on the other side of that, that would be impacted. So as we look at this type of structure, it's probably going to lend itself more to traditional classroom settings as opposed to a music room.
Go ahead,
then. From a HVAC side of things, from a where is that included, or is that a is
yeah,
that
yes. That's part of the modular building.
Well, sorry, where was that in the I'm just thinking, like, from a when it's 7 below out this week,
yes.
What is it going to feel like in that classroom? Or when it's 100 degrees out in August, what is it going to feel like in that classroom?
Right. So the modular buildings do have an insulation value.
Right.
I'm not sure what the R value is, but they do have heating and cooling units associated with them. So it would be on their own system.
Okay. But is it efficient enough is it spec'd well enough to be able to keep up with the brutal winters and the hot summers, if it happens? Or is it going to be?
I'd say they're engineered buildings.
Yeah. I would think it should be, but that would be something that we could get those specifications on moving forward.
Okay. Anyone else?
Questions? All right. Were you going to report on, I know we talked about another option or looking at that space?
In the Red Tail Library?
Yes.
Media Center, yep.
Yeah.
Over winter break, we're planning on...
Hang on 1 second. Can you over here? You guys
sorry.
Ready?
Yeah, sorry.
Okay. Go ahead.
We are going to add a space in the Red Tail Media Center opposite of the computer lab. Going to add a room, so a partition wall and a doorway.
With that being specified for what class, type of class?
There's been a couple ideas. Music breakout or art breakout.
Okay. And that's something that you can complete over break? It'll be completed, so ready for a second semester, whatever, second
yes.
year end, okay. Okay. So I would ask, is this something that we want administration to spend more time on, the portables, or not? There were board members that wanted this information brought forward. I guess I'm looking at you guys if you want.
I'm not thinking of that personally.
Yeah. I guess I'd like to see what happens at Red Tail Ridge.
Once we do this temporary.
Yes.
Or, yeah.
Yeah. Over the holiday break, yeah.
Right, because that will have more of an instant impact than this is March at the earliest.
Yeah.
So
I think if we find that we still need more space than the three-ish months of implementation, we can do that something like this. If we choose to over summer for the following year, so it's a full year. Benefit versus a two-ish month benefit that we see.
So it's something I
appreciate that the staff did take the time to take a look at that because we do have a lot of families. We're all feeling that.
Right.
And we are trying to do the best that we can.
Right.
Can we assume going forward those costs are pretty much in line? So say some of the building, i.e. the high school, would want to expand, that we could basically use those numbers? I know there's going to be incremental costs that are...
You know, it's also site-specific. I mean, I don't think every site lends itself to portables. I mean, we'd certainly have to look at every site in individual.
And I think you had mentioned, too, as did our consultants, the actual... When you focus in on the site of where it would be, that then really nails down some of your costs from the... How close you are utilities, what the foundation would look like, those types of things.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, so it sounds like we're going to put this aside. Okay. All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. And next up is new business, the demographic study.
Good evening again. We did have Hazel Reinhardt do a demographic study for us. Hazel's here tonight to discuss this. She's been very gracious to come to this board meeting. Our report wasn't supposed to be due until the end of the month, and Hazel was very helpful in having us come early to report to the board before, so that we had information in time for any facility committee meetings that we may have that would need this information. She has not completed all of it, and so you're getting the first of the report. And then later on, we'll have more information concerning our elementary schools. So Hazel?
Good evening.
Good evening.
My pleasure to be here. Madam Chairman, board members, superintendent. This report is complete except for the elementary schools. And we're struggling a little bit with data at this moment yet. So I don't know how much time we have.
Mm-hmm. The evening's yours.
Well, you know, I love to talk about this, so maybe you don't want to give me such open-ended time. As you'll notice here, this is resident enrollment that I projected, and I made that decision actually before I knew you were going to limit open enrollment. Basically, once a school district has more than 10% of its enrollment, of open enrollment, I prefer to make resident projections because it just affects things and you don't control it. You don't, because it's something you can make policy decisions about. And then people say to me, oh, you underprojected, or you did this or you did that. Well, of course, you made a very major decision that maybe you didn't know you were going to make, but certainly I didn't at the time I did it. So that's one thing. Number two, I tried to make total projections and found them not very satisfactory because resident enrollment and open enrollment are driving two different things, and they were just producing huge numbers. So I, when I saw that, I knew that, that it just wasn't believable. So, and then I talked to Julie, and she said, well, they're considering limiting open enrollment. what I'd like to do tonight is to do what I usually do, to take a look at what's happened, what I think will happen, why I think it will happen, and then we'll take a look at some numbers that support that. If we look at the past 10 years, now we're going to talk here first about total enrollment. You can see that in the past 10 years, you had an increase in students of almost 1,500 students. Okay? And that it excludes early childhood and the ALC. That's a percentage up in the top percentages in the metro area. Okay? Your resident enrollment increased by 859 students, or 13.5%. So you can see how powerful the growth in open enrollment was. Now, the resident enrollment, we'll look at that a little more, but it has a very interesting pattern to it. It's really increased rapidly only in the past 2 years, and then especially in the past year. So it's not like it has a long trend of rapid increase. And what's really changed is that the resident net migration has increased in the past 3 years, probably a reflection of a recovery in the housing market. Okay, before that it was not bad, but nothing that was going to drive growth very much. And then the other thing that's occurred is that the natural decrease, by that I mean the difference between the size of the incoming kindergarten and the previous year's grade 12, has become smaller. So that gave a little impetus to growth. Now, non-resident enrollment over that same period increased by almost 600 students. And non-residents are 12.3% of your total enrollment as of this fall. Market share here, do a very, very good job of capturing the students who live in your district. Market share is almost 85%. That's higher than typical for Twin Cities suburban school districts. And the increase in share is another factor that has driven enrollment growth. Okay? So, and some of that, once that's happened, you can't recapture. Some of it is kind of one time, if you will. Now, as we look toward the future, again, looking at resident enrollment, this fall, 7,206 resident students. I'm projecting 8,700 all the way to 9,500, with increases across the board. Although I have to tell you, the risk of the last five projection years being too high is pretty great, especially in the highest projections, because it would call for a pretty rapid continued increase in housing stock after 2021, 22, 23, as we know the population will be seriously into aging at that point. So. But the first 5 years, I think we have every reason to be somewhat comfortable with. Now, in the next 5 years, we have an additional 1,191 single-family detached housing units projected to come online. And at the current yields, those additional units, plus there are some townhomes, some apartments, given the current yields, would produce 1,032 additional students. Okay. Now, not all, the net effect may not be that great because you still will have some of this natural decrease, but I think you should get at least a net of 800 out of that. And then in this district, as single-family detached units sell, student yield increases. Therefore, as you have turnover in housing, you actually get a few additional students with that as well. So a lot of factors there point to continued growth. Now, what could happen to make these projections too high? Well, fewer housing units built because of a recession or other market factors. Fewer units up for sale, therefore less opportunity for families to move into the district. Increased competition for students. Expanded charter school, a second charter school. I don't think you're at risk too much to open enrollment, but we have to keep our eyes on that. And then if we should have a further decrease in fertility rates, you know, people just have fewer kids. If we look at education choice here, you can see that compared to statewide, a smaller percentage of your students are in non-public settings. Open enrollment, you can see huge in, not quite at the state level out, but about the same percentage as the state in charter schools, and then you can see a substantially higher capture rate than statewide. And these data are for 2014-15, the last time I looked, which was last week, the state had still not posted the 15-16 data. So this is a little bit old, but you can look at how you compare statewide. And then I want to really highlight non-public enrollment because administration did a great job in tracking all of this down, and so we know we're dealing with students that are actually resident of this district. But if you can look at what happened to enrollment of residents at St. Michael's Catholic School, decreased from 474 to 285 since 2007-08. That's pretty typical. The district residents attending St. Paul Lutheran School decreased from 30 to 14 between 2009-10 and 16-17. You had a small increase, 25 to 50, at Prior Lake Christian Academy. And so basically that's what helped your share go up, is that these declines. And district residents being homeschooled has been flat. Oh, it varies year to year, but it's about 135 a year. In the public options, you can see here what's happened to open enrollment from 411 to 1,008. Open enrollment out the first couple years there looks suspiciously high. I don't know, but you can see as we come into the latter years that open enrollment out is fairly modest for a district of this size because open enrollment is increasing in numbers and percentages every year in Minnesota, year after year after year. It's a growing phenomenon. And then you can see the number of students in charter schools and then in your ALC. So in making projections, I use two methodologies. One, cohort survival, or some people call it a cohort component method. It's a traditional way of projecting population. You look at the base, you add what would be births, in this case, the entry of kindergarten, and those who exit by graduating or by moving, both in or out. And then I use the housing unit method. The cohort survival is a far more precise method. Its limitation is that it's slow to pick up in the survival rates in rapid increases in housing. The housing unit method is a much cruder method, but it's very useful if you have a lot of new housing units coming online, and you can pinpoint that geographically to particular elementary schools, and that's its advantage. The projections I make are for 10 years. I look at the long term, not the annual, and I always say do not use these numbers for your annual budget because people are surprised, but it's a different mindset in making a short-term projection versus a long-term projection. I want to make it very clear, I do not have a crystal ball. I do not know the future. What I do know is what's related to what. Yeah, and that's what I work with. So I'm looking for evidence that provide clues to future enrollment. And then I always want to remind people about randomness and fluctuation, because there is randomness, and there are things that happen that we simply don't know why they happened. They were not predictable, and they just happened. Okay, let's look at enrollment here, and I want to focus now on the resident enrollment. If you'll notice that every couple of 2-3 years, it's sort of flat, moves up a little bit, and then it comes to another stage, it's there for a little bit, and then as you can see what's happened in the really 2015-16 and 2016-17 when it really took off. Components of change. Here we look at, again, that difference between the size of the incoming kindergarten class and the previous year's grade 12. If the number is positive, it's natural increase. If it's negative, it's a decrease. And then net migration, we can't separate here who actually moved across the school district boundaries. So that shows it could be the transfer from a non-public school, could be a transfer from the charter school. And again, I remind you, these are all district residents. You will see that natural decrease cost you 209 students. It was a downward pressure because every year except the first two, you had more students in grade 12 than you had the next year in kindergarten. And net migration, you had net in-migration of 1,068, and of course the combination of those two is the enrollment change. So the natural decrease is the phenomena of an aging population, and that is that you have people, you know, just aging out of having kids in school, and they remain living here. And then here are the resident enrollment numbers by year. And I look at a couple of things. First of all, I look across the kindergarten line, the row at the very top. And you can see that the last 2 years, kindergarten, resident kindergarten has been higher. In 2008-09 was 469, which is very close to the 471. But in the time in between that time, it really was lower. So the last 2 years, 471 and 509. If you then look down 2016-17, what you can see right away is that your elementary grades are smaller than your middle school and high school grades. I'll talk this a little bit about the implications of that. And that really what bottom line means is you have to continue to have kindergarten classes of this size, of the 2509 or thereabouts, or over time you would have decline because you'll be graduating out larger numbers. Then if you look at the diagonal, if you look at 457 to 454 to 469 to 453, that's the migration. Okay, and that resident cohort of 457 in 2007-08 is in grade 9, and now it is 588. So you can see then the effect over time of movement into the district. The average resident grade size, this is just simple, but we take K to 5 and we divide it by 6 because there are 6 grades in there. The average resident grade is 520. At K-5, it's 593. At 6-8, and it's 577 at 9-12. Now we have net inflows in this district in resident students at grade 6 and grade 9. So the differences in the average grade sizes point to continuing enrollment increases if kindergarten remains near today's level. It's got to stay close to this level or it would trend downward. Now, as we put our minds to looking at the future, one of the most challenging things is to project kindergarten. And there is a relationship between the number of children born and the number of students entering kindergarten 5 to 6 years later. In the state of Minnesota, you have to be age 5 by September 1st. So we want to adjust that, and I call that the kindergarten pool. Here, what I have in front of us are district resident births obtained from the health department by address. However, in the state of Minnesota, an out-of-wedlock birth, parents can request that it not be available by address. Mysterious to me, because this is the number of percentage of unwedlock births is increasing, and the percentage of people may vary a year from year to year who say they are willing to have that data available by address or not. Okay, bottom line, what this says, if we look at the addresses, the births coded to the district, we have a 21% decline in this 15 years. You're shaking your head. Okay. Now, I've struggled with this. This is a problem because I do so many of these. It's been a problem south of the river, more so than elsewhere. And I don't know why, but I've gotten suspicious. So said, okay, let's look at some other proxies. Well, the district, what's available, reported with all births published, are for municipalities. And so I have data for the city of Prior Lake and for the city of Savage, which are the largest component parts of the district. And I verified, I eyeballed it on the map, then I verified it with the city. 40 to 45% of the city of Savage is in this school district. So what I did was I took these births and 45% of Savage's births, and I'm gonna use them as a proxy, okay? And doing that and adjusting it for the pool, the births only go down about 12.5%. Not that 21, okay? So what I decided is that I would forego a year of data, because the address data I could get until, you know, September of August 31st of this year, if I wanted it, for what I believe to be a better set of data in using the cities. Now, what I want to call to your attention is we can see that there's been a decline in the number of births in Scott County since 2002. In Minnesota, births reached a high point in 2007, which was the case in the nation as well, and that's a high point since 1964, but nowhere near what the number was in 64. And as you can see, births have been going down in Minnesota and the nation, attributed to the recession. They started to move up a little bit, and now 2015 is lower than 2014. What we're seeing, what's being much discussed, is that the millennials are delaying childbearing. And what is the unknown is, of course, childbearing delayed can become childbearing foregone if you wait long enough. So that's still one of the iffy questions here of whether we'll get any little uptick at all from these. The state is projecting almost no increase in births between now and 2025, which puts us into a pretty low pattern for increased kindergarten students. Now, I'll go here, I'll show you. I call it the city's pool, meaning 100% of Prior Lake and 45% of Savage adjusted to the pool. You can see what that looks like. That is declining. And then I look at the percentage of your resident kindergarten to that pool. You see the percentages have been increasing. I think there are a couple of reasons for that. Number one is that first of all, more people are moving into the district, so you have more kindergarten students who are not born in the district. They moved here as preschoolers. The other thing is that perhaps we're seeing a higher percentage of savage births, or a lower percentage early on to a higher percentage later. But what's really important here is that as of the class of 2016-17, it's over 100%. And we know logically that it should never be over 100. It shouldn't be over 100% unless you've had significant number of kindergartners move in, because we have to, some percentage are going to charter schools, open enrolled, out, homeschooled, whatever. So this tells us that we're, in these most recent kindergarten, the last 2 years especially, we're seeing a number of resident kindergarten students who were not born in the district. We know they had to have migrated here as preschoolers. Now, the importance of this table is that we see the pool from which we have the next 4 years of kindergarten. And that pool is not very robust. And, you know, it just doesn't have much lift to it here. Now, if I come back here, I'm looking for a way to smooth this out. So I'm looking at some averages. In the past 4 years, the average was 93.3%. The past 3 years, 95.7%. The past two, 99.8%. The past year was 102.2%. So what I'm seeing is this increase. So I have the pool, and now I need to find a percent that, or percent, a couple of them that I want to project from. And the decision I made here was that for the resident kindergarten, I would take the average of the past 2 years, which is 99.8%, as a low assumption, and the high at the current rate. Now, I could have taken it higher, but I don't know, I thought that was a little more risky. And then longer term, I applied the shape of the Minnesota zero-year-old trajectory. So this is what the state of Minnesota is projecting, State Demographic Center. You can see just virtually nothing occurring in the number of births. So what does that mean for you? I think you'll get a few more births probably. In fact, I thought the trajectory, I doubled it from what the state would be because of where you are, but it's still not a very robust number. And then I applied these percentages. So you can see here, for the first few years, you're going on the births that have occurred. And then you can see after 2021, we're looking at projected births. And you can see going from 509 residents, the lower projection doesn't really have more resident kindergarten students in a consistent way until, 2021, 2022, whereas the higher one is consistently higher than you are today. And you can see compared to the past 10 years, in which you had a total of 4,481 resident kindergarten students, these are substantially higher. As far as net migration is concerned, here you see that pattern that I've talked about. This past year is just sort of blew out of the water. Previous year was very strong. Year before that, strong. Before that, not particularly large, you know, for size. And here we see it at the grade level, and I've bolded the two transition points in which you get a large inflow of residents from the transition of 5 to 6, which is entry of the middle school, and then the entry of the high school. And the migration then is converted to survival rates. And again, you'll see in bolded here, the two transition points. Now, the comparison of these two rates, most of the difference lies in those two transition points of grades 5 to 6 and 8 to 9. otherwise they're relatively similar. And now we're going to marry those two assumptions of the kindergarten and the migration to make projections. And in looking at the, look at the projections in just a minute, but in looking at them, the migration assumptions have a much larger effect on the numbers, a much larger swing, close to 650 student difference in 10 years. Versus the kindergarten ones for about 160. So what this tells us is that if we have uneasiness about any of this, where we want to shine the light is on those migration, because that's what's moving this about a lot. Doesn't mean the kindergarten is necessarily accurate, but it means that what I think are reasonable assumptions are still relatively similar to each other in their outcome. And then here are the projections of the cohort, and we see the marriage of the low kindergarten with the low migration, high kindergarten with the low migration, low kindergarten with the high, and the high with the high. So that's what tells us again that the migration numbers are really what are powerful in driving the differences in these projections. And then you can see here from 7206 to 8716. 8874, 9352, and 9517 in 10 years. These are, again, resident students. Then I take these and break them into the way you have your schools configured at K5, 6, 8, and 9, 12. And you can see what I want to point out, that in the first 5 years at the middle school, the kindergarten assumptions have no effect, only the current grade size and the migration, because they have those students haven't reached middle school yet. And then in the second five projection years, of course, the kindergarten assumptions make a difference. At the high school level, only the migration makes a difference. Only the last 2 years of the projection is really has any impact of kindergarten, because remember that in 2026-27, we'll only have 2 years that have been projected from the birth. So that's that. We're really looking at migration there, what we assume to be entering the middle school and the high school, driving those high school numbers. So if we felt we needed modifications, again, we'd know where we wanted to look. Then as part of this study, we looked at housing in the district. We look at this from tax records. And we're interested here in the type of housing units and their student yield. And again, this is always resident student yield, because we take the tax data and we overlay the students by address. And what we see in this school district is what we see in districts in three states in which I've worked and done this kind of work, in Minnesota, Wisconsin, and Illinois, and that is that the yield is significantly higher in single-family detached units. So that single-family detached units are what are really critical in producing school-age kids. And you'll see that the yield is 0.57, slightly over more than a half a student for a single-family detached, 0.20 for a townhome, not much coming out. We don't have an account of your number of apartments, but normally apartments run about 0.11 to 0.15. You can see condominiums produce, you have 309 condominiums for six resident students. Duplex, triplex, here again, south of the river, they produce quite a few kids. 0.76, but you don't have very many twin homes. So again, we see about 85% of your students come out of these single family detached units. Again, we see what we see virtually everywhere, that the newest units have the highest yield of students. Now these are, again, your students, resident, Prior Lake Savage area public school students. In the units built 2000 to present, 0.83. in the 90 0.61, in the 80 0.51, pre-19 80 0.29. So we can also see that some of the aging in place going on there. As far as value of units, again, we see a pretty typical pattern that higher valued units yield more students than lower value units, and that's very counterintuitive to many people. But you'll see here that your units at 400,000 plus have virtually the same yield as those 250 to 399, but less at the 249 or less, even though the spread there is not as great. In some districts, actually, the very highest value units have the largest number of children. Now, here we're looking at new units built and why new single-family units become so important for growth. These new units were built in 2014-15. The Scott County tax records don't have 2016 units incorporated. Some counties do, but not here. But 0.81 if it's a brand new unit. And then we're looking at units that existed pre-2014, those that were sold and then those that were not sold. And so you can see that slight increase in unit that's sold. So again, we're looking, if you get these new units, you know, likelihood of 0.81, thereabouts. And that is not the highest I've seen in the metro area. New unit yield. And then looking here at the yield by the component parts of the district, and you can see here the number of single-family detached units in these various component parts, their median value, the number of students out of, and then the yield, so variation across the district. And then here's projected development for the next 5 years. And you see the 1,191 in single family detached, 48 in townhomes, and 550 in apartments. And based on the yields that we have today, those 1,195 single family detached will produce 965 students, the 48 townhouses, 7, the 550 apartments, approximately 60. And now the net effects of this resident enrollment may be slightly less depending on the level of natural decrease that occurs during the 5 years, which probably will be based on the cohort, somewhere 200 to 250 maybe still natural decrease over that. So the sum of this is over 1,000 units, so you should net out somewhere around 800, say, if these units are all built. Okay, and then here I'm showing what the comparison. 2021-22, 5 years out, housing unit method, 8,238 residents, students. And then you see that that falls really right in between the two low migration projections and the two high migration projections. So it's verifying that these numbers are tracking in the ballpark. Now, if that housing development does not happen, then of course you won't have that kind of growth. And then I looked at non-resident enrollment, and it has some interesting things to it. You can see how much it is concentrated in the elementary grades versus the high school grades. And that as of this year, you really have twice, almost twice as many kindergarten students as you have grade 12 in non-residents. And then I looked at the net migration, and this is a very odd pattern, very unusual. Between 2012, the fall of 12 and 13, you had a net in-migration of 93. Then 2013 to 1475, then you dropped to 4, and now it's a minus 47. Now, some of that minus 47, actually, they may have been non-residents in 2015 and were residents in 2016. because most school districts see some portion of open enrollment reflects people who are interested in moving to the school district and just haven't found a house or something hasn't happened for them. Or they open enroll the child and love the district so much that they make the decision to move. So that's part, but this minus 47 is, after seeing these large numbers, is really, it's kind of perplexing of what's happening there. And then I didn't anticipate you would be quite so dramatic in your decline, but I modeled out, if we use this past year's net migration and we held kindergarten, what it would look like in 10 years, how quickly you would reduce the number. And, it goes down. It goes down, and pretty dramatically, really. So, and there are other things we could model with that. And we could take it to 50, we could do what, you see it going down. Now, so what I need to say is that the resident projections need non-resident enrollment added onto them to get to your total enrollment. And that's why it's useful to have two different schedules of them. But wanted very much to focus on the resident population. So I would be happy to answer any questions anyone has. You will be getting a written report, I hope, before Christmas. And we'll have the individual elementary schools, because development is not equally spread in the district either. So we want to look at its effect at particular elementary buildings.
All right. Well, thank you very much. It's a lot of great information. Any questions? Rich?
No, I'd have to spend some more time looking. A lot of numbers. I guess it kind of confirms what we already know, that our district is a second house for young families for net migration. So they usually buy their first house, have their first child or two, and then upgrade into our district. Is that what your numbers are telling us?
Well, when we here's the best way to look at it. One of the things that I continue to need to remind myself, but I'm much older than you are, that the world doesn't operate like it once did. I grew up in a world in which people had a starter house and then they moved up and maybe they moved up again. Young people don't do that nearly as often. If they have the resources, they buy their dream home right away. But this on migration really tells us the story here. If you look at this across the years, K to 1, you have, and this is true virtually in every district in Minnesota, you have a net in migration. This past year was just, huge. Then from 1 to 2, you have it. 2 to 3, but you notice not much 3 to 4. If you look over the years, 4 to 5, again, it's picked up in the last years. 5 to 6, imagine 80 kids appeared in grade 6 who weren't in your 5th grade the previous year in the district. I mean, that's a lot of kids. Then again, 7, 8, and then look, 78 entering high school. And then those negative numbers are what we're seeing is people, students moving to alternatives. And I'd like to keep that in front of districts because we know that students who go to alternative learning centers don't have the same graduation rate like, So but you're not atypical in any way. But you're getting very strong growth in those early elementary grades, and then these transition points here, like with this. Look at the 5 to 6. It started out 5, 15, 0, 22, 4, minus 4, 22, 39, 80. Just huge. And you see in the past 3 years, you've run 70, 74, 75 entering high school. So it also suggests that you're getting some families wanting to make this transition for their children, students at the high school, saying we want to get them to the Prior Lake High School. And whether that will, you know, if we look over this longer period of time, we know that we're going to have inflow at both of those points, but whether they'll remain as strong as this, especially at that sixth grade level. That's where the migration percentages are need to be examined.
That's a newer trend, it looks like. I mean, comparative to the high school.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay, Todd.
Would I be wrong to say that you can predict with almost a surety that barring some major catastrophe through the housing market or economy, that this district will grow at least for the next 5 years?
I believe so, unless there's something dramatic happening.
And more than likely that will continue for the next 10 years.
Yes. The rate may be a little slower, but yes. There's first of all, you have land still to be, you know, developed. It will probably be as much affected by where jobs are located, you know, because Twin City people have had a long history of long commutes, but traffic is getting worse, and so I think more people are being more conscious of selecting places. I wouldn't say closer to where they work, but not quite as far, not totally cross metro commutes.
Well, and this mirrors and matches what we've heard in the past, really for the last 6 years that we've been on the board. What did concern us was a demographic similar along those lines that came out from the city of Prior Lake that showed a huge aging out and a actual shrinkage of it, which we didn't believe because we don't see those numbers in our thing. This confirms that.
Yeah.
I believe the numbers are flawed.
Yeah, I haven't seen those numbers. One of the key things in projections for a city like that is one's assumptions of how many people are going to stay in their home versus move to something else.
Well, the scariest thing for me is the 400 units on the old Napa site, which opens up homes here for inflow of families, which are that 80 or 58%,
yes.
Or 0.58 kids per household. So.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
And the other thing I would add is the value of single family units here is high enough that people can buy a condo, sort of even trade. That's not true in some of the inner ring suburbs. I mean that you have a home valued at less than $250, and you can't buy a condo for very much. So that really holds people in place. But I think here the value is sufficient that people could move and turn them if they want.
Thank you.
Yes. Any other questions?
With Savage and that whole Red Tail Ridge area. But we also know that there's a lot of growth west, southwest, directly south of Shakopee in that core business community. Is there any way that we can see where as the years come, are we, you know, we might need another elementary over there? Are we seeing any kind of information?
Well,
like that?
We will take a look at that when we look at the elementary schools, because we will see each attendance area and the projected growth in the attendance area. And each of those schools will have its own yield rates because they will vary a little bit. So that's what that will do. So you can really look at that and see it.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay, no. Thank you very much. It was
thank
very
you.
Informative. And thank you for working on ours first. I know that was, we took a little priority and we really do appreciate it.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, next up is the curriculum course schedule updates and changes.
Good evening again.
I'm medicated here, man. Holy cow.
As I'm calling the presentation up, I'm going to invite Dave Lund up and Ms. Melanie Smija. Just to give a little preface this evening, Mr. Schuttinger is not able to be with us this evening, so I am presenting his portion of the presentation. Every December or the fall of every year, we do go through a process where we look at new courses for the 17-18 school year, and this is a process that happens at our sites, at middle school and high school. And so this has come forward through curriculum advisory and presentation. So there's two parts of our presentation this evening. We have high school. Mr. Lund is going to be talking about several course proposals that have come through the process that we're seeking approval on this evening so that we can move forward with putting them in our course catalog. And then second of all, Ms. Smija is going to be giving an update on MNCAPS for year two healthcare and business pathway courses, as well as a proposed third pathway for your consideration. We're seeking approval on all of these this evening so that we can move forward with getting our registration materials prepared and moving forward with registering students. So with that, Mr. Lund.
All right, in your packets, good evening, Board Chair Rural, School Board Superintendent Stallo. In your packets, you should have the recommendations or our recommendations for courses to add to Prior Lake High School's registration manual for this year. Very quickly, we have math and industrial technology. It's merging math with hands-on industrial technology. It's actually a class I've been looking to, you know, get somewhere into the business or the IT department for a number of years, and our IT department wants to take this on, do some teaming with the math department, and get those transferable skills, especially for the hands-on students that, you know, it's applicable math. The second one is advanced manufacturing. It's a capstone course for those students who are in our IT program. Just so you know, our IT program is growing rapidly over the last 3-4 years. 4 years ago, we had 1.2 instructors. Now we have 2.8, and it's just going up. Part of that is a credit to our three instructors who are bringing us, you know, in the current age of what students need, and that's where the advanced manufacturing comes. And the third one out of theirs is Project DII for Women. We have more and more young ladies taking our course, and they're looking for something a little different. They're looking for those skills that they can take, and not so much career, but useful stuff around the house. We want to turn that and show them what careers are out there. And so this is geared towards young ladies to show them what kind of careers there are in for women in manufacturing, industrial technology, and engineering. And that's Project DII for Women. German 5 to S2S, as we get more students coming in the middle school, we're running into students who are taking German 4 as juniors, and it's for college credit. This would be the next level of that course. So we're another college level course through St. Cloud State. S2S stands for senior to sophomore, and it's the next sequence of courses for there. And then if you remember last fall, I came before you and we had some interest in offering American Sign Language. We were hoping we'd get enough students for one section. I think we have 125 to 127 students enrolled in four sections, and it's a very popular course. And obviously with that many students, we feel we need an American Sign Language too. Hopefully we can get at least a sequence of those three credit courses, so students that go on and want a three credit, it qualifies as a world language course for college. I just have to throw in what's very unique about this is obviously students tell me they like it because they don't have to write. Again, we're not, but you know, you do have a lot of students that are hands-on learners and really tactile learners, and American Sign Language speaks very much to them and is a very useful skill in society. So those are the courses, and we'll entertain any questions that you have.
All right, is there any questions? Okay, seeing none.
Thank you for your consideration.
Do we have a motion to accept Prior Lake High School's classes for next year, for 2017-18?
So moved.
By Chad, second by Melissa. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? That passes 6-0.
Well, thank you for having me here this evening, Madam Chair, Dr. Salo, and board members. I'm here to give an update on the courses that we are looking to offer at MNCAPS next year. So you'll see for our business pathway year one, we have some slight adjustments as to the current year one that we have currently in our pathway. And we are now looking to offer AP macroeconomics in the fall and then AP microeconomics in the spring. And the current staff member that we have teaching economics is excited about this opportunity and offering that course with the team that they are currently teaching with. And this is similar to other pathways and business pathways in the CAPS network as well. Then for year two, we are looking to have business finance in the fall and entrepreneurship in the spring with AP statistics throughout the full year. And with this, we would still offer just in year one the projects with the business partners in the fall semester and spring semester. With year two, we'd have the projects in the fall semester with our partners. And then that second semester would almost be like a senior capstone where the students would use everything they learned over the last year and a half and then be given the opportunity to be entrepreneur-like and share and create their own project or business and bring that forward and use everything that they've learned throughout the years and then end with a Shark Tank type of situation where the business partners can kind of decide who they want to invest in regards to the business that they've created. So a great way to cap off that second year for someone who was a junior and took it their junior year for year one and then senior year for year two. And the college credits that are proposed there, I've already been with the teacher that would be teaching it would be assigned to those courses through Hennepin Technical College. Looking at the medicine healthcare pathway for year one, there's been no adjustments to the pathway for that first year, except that there is a name change to one of the classes we are going to be currently teaching this spring semester. We currently have it titled Contemporary Health Issues, but Normandale changed the name of the course to Personal and Community Health, and we want to change our course name so that it follows the transcripts and keeps it clear that way. So that would be the only adjustment there. Then what we are proposing for year two would be to offer Introduction to Exercise Science in the fall semester, and then the Nursing Assistant Certificate in the spring semester, along with AP Psychology throughout the full year. This has been a pathway that has brought in a lot of discussion from staff members in both districts of interest in teaching within it, seeing the potential of having the AP Psychology along with these two courses within there, and our business partners and our students as well. We're working with some local business partners such as the Fountains of Hosanna and getting students more opportunity to get in there and work with the residents there, which would also lead into the Nursing Assistant Certificate because we need a lot more hands-on experience and real-world experience for the students. And there's a lot of pieces to bring in a nurse to work with the students. And we have several partners right now, mentors, guest instructors that would really benefit from doing this with our students, and the students would benefit greatly. So after they finish the course, they can take the test and have their CNA and work as a nursing assistant throughout college as they pursue their other goals and passions. So then the proposed pathway for the third pathway would be technology and design. And really we've looked at this and discussed it with several business partners. We started with this discussion by doing the same path that we did last year by looking at what the students were interested in and using their ACT information that they shared of their interest levels. And it came back that medicine, healthcare, and business are still the top two. But this year, medicine healthcare was the number one, where that adjusted from last year, which business was number one. And then technology and engineering came in third. So that was just a sign right away that this is a student interest from our students in both school districts and all three high schools. And then as we started conversations with business partners as well, even that second weekend, we had someone come in and we asked, you know, if we would offer a third pathway, where do you see the need? And right, it's IT, computer science, you know, design, all those pieces. Meeting with people at Thomson Reuters about what they see, and one voice I heard strongly was having technical writing within computer science and design pathways with technology. So as we would look at having the AP Computer Science A course that would be throughout the full year. And then graphic design, which is currently being taught in our business pathway this year, we are going to adjust that and put that in the technology and design pathway, and then have web design and development in the spring. And we've spoken with that staff member that's currently going to be teaching this spring, and she is excited about this opportunity, and that we would be able to earn college credits through Hennepin Technical College for those courses with graphic design and web design and development. And then offering technical writing in the fall and interpersonal communications in the spring. This along would also have the projects that we have working with business partners, the one-to-one mentorship, and everything that we have going on currently within our program. One piece that I am really excited about with offering this pathway is that we would look to offer it at the same time as the business year one pathway. And right now, we have our business students doing these fabulous projects for several companies like Polaris and Synopta, rockminnesota.org, and they could use some design piece to help make them look maybe even a little bit better and more professional, and we could allow for that cross collaboration between the two pathways. Just as I remember seeing when I went down to Blue Valley CAPS, we were in there with working with students, and some of them left the room to go talk to another pathway to get some help on a project they were working on. And it would be exciting to really help our students not be so siloed anymore, but really be able to work interconnected within the pathways. And so offering that would really help elevate both of them and doing projects for each other as well as the companies they're working on. So that piece is really exciting to be able to allow that for the students as well. So any questions? Jen?
No real questions, just a comment. This is amazing. I come up from IT, and it's really needed in this area. There's actually a negative unemployment in the metro area for IT, and it's just amazing that we're going to be pushing out students who can instantly get a job and a pretty well-paying job. And my wife started with her CNA, and it's a great way to go right into nursing, and I'm really happy to see that we're offering that, too. It's amazing. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Just a reminder that these were reviewed during the district curriculum advisory committee.
Okay. That's how you come forward. And I'm assuming Lakeville's getting the same presentation.
Yep, I was at the Lakeville's advisory committee earlier today, okay. And then came over here to share with the Prior Lake advisory committee, and I'm here this evening, and I will be at Lakeville's school board next Tuesday.
Lucky you.
I guess one question, yep, that we may not know the answer to, how are the student numbers looking for next year?
Well, we don't know that yet. And so that's part of the piece that we have our information sessions coming up that first week of January. And already every morning, there's so many alerts of people that are RSVPing that are planning to come on that Tuesday, Wednesday, or Thursday night. And even for our webinar that's on that following Thursday, we've had a lot of RSVPs for parents and people interested to attend that. So we're seeing the interest. We do have the application is available online already. And so students are applying. We already have some applications to look through. It's been great reading some of their responses and their interest there. So we'll be then starting to interview the week after or soon after we do the info sessions. And that's how we get a really good idea. As last year, we kind of had an idea where our numbers were before registration closed. And that's also a request by our assistant principals and counselors and deans that they have an idea before that end date. So, and I also really enjoy the interviews because it's fun to see the students shine.
Okay, any other questions? All right, seeing none. Do I have a motion to approve the MNCAPS pathways as listed?
So moved.
By Chad, second?
Second.
By Dan. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? That passes 6-0.
Thank you very much.
Okay. And then next up is the adopt the 2016 payable 2017 final levy certification, which
the board will be adopting what was presented at the truth and taxation hearing, okay, at that 2.86% increase.
Okay. All right. Do I have a motion to accept the 2016 payable 2017 final levy certification?
So moved.
By Rich. Second?
Second.
By Dan. Any questions? All right. Yes.
Yeah, I was going to say, we've seen it quite a few times now. All right, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That passes 6-0. And then the final 2016-17 budget approval.
And you've seen this as well at the previous work study session. This is our, it's really no change from that meeting. Our budgeted enrollment when we started the year in June, we anticipated 8,150 students. Our October 1 numbers were 8,316. We anticipated a few students for those open enrollment outside of Normandale School, community school district, or not a school district, but college, allowing for our student reduction. And so we're updating our enrollment based on 8,275 students. With that additional 125 students, a little over $1 million, we had some additional special ed revenue simply due to we have additional special ed expenditures, but also on a change in how they are allocating those funds. So you'll see that of $460,000 and a decrease in that in achievement and integration. If you recall from our truth and taxation hearing, we had a decrease in the levy, and you're seeing the corresponding decrease in the aid for that component. So a total increase in revenue of $1.1 million, and you can see how they are spread out by the different categories of revenue. For expenditures, we had some additional students attending. As you recall, we pay for students who attend PSEO at Normandale Community College, and so therefore there we have additional expenditures there. Some additional staff development due to the increased enrollment, additional gifted and talented. And then we have staffing additions, which have all been board approved previously. So for a total of $730,452. For capital expenditures, we anticipate about a $200,000 expenditure to develop those fields south of the high school. And then some, we anticipated additional about $212,000 for some additional curriculum based on that enrollment growth, furniture, some remodeling that we're doing to accommodate for those students. So that's $412,799 for that expenditure. And then where we're placing those, again, the different areas where those expenditures are placed. We do have some carryover from some different areas, and so we will are utilizing those fund balances, and that's what that difference is. So $1.444 million of expenditures. And you can see the allocation here. Again, you've seen this before. We are definitely within our fund balance policy. Not much of a, it's a slight decrease in our unassigned, total unassigned from $11,099,000 to $11,022,000, and our overall general fund, a decrease of about $500,000. For, and this is a preliminary budget that was approved, so you can make the comparisons. And then changes to our other funds, food service. We needed additional serving counters at the high school and an additional staffing to accommodate for the, that another counter. And then we have additional adjustments made in community education just due to class offerings and preschool class programs. And then a little bit of an increase in our internal service fund simply due to participation and increased participation in our health and dental programs and our HRA contributions. So you can see our food service fund balance, we anticipate that will go down about $50,000. Simply that's due to that additional serving counter, and our community education is pretty steady. Overall, you do see, I want to just point out our total debt service. That big expenditure isn't, that's money that's been sitting in escrow and because of our refunding, and that will pay off that final bond payment. So it's not, that money is sitting in an escrow account. It's not part of our total budget here. So, And you can see on our OPEB that we just have an interest payment there because we didn't bond for, or we didn't levy for that this year. And that's all I have. Oh, I do have one more thing, I'm sorry. In your front of you, we have this booklet. This is new this year. I wanted having, you know, several questions about where we're at financially with our district. And as you go through this, this gives quite a bit of information about our district, starting with just an overview of our finances, our Prior Lake Secondary School boundaries, and where the schools are located for those elementary schools. And just some points of pride, things that we do in our district that may be a little bit different than other districts. Some basic information about where our money comes from, information about enrollment and growth in our district. We're the 26th largest school district in Minnesota, the 6th largest high school in Minnesota. Talks about our enrollment and our growth, our per pupil costs. As we know, we spend about $1,400 less per pupil unit than other metro school districts. That information and showing the per pupil teacher ratio is also in there. Referendum dollars by district, showing what our referendum is compared to other districts and the tech levies. That's been a lot of information that people have been interested in seeing. And so we did some information about that. Talks about our strategic plan and our goals. It has the budget that the board just approved in here. That's why it's just coming out to you today. Talks generally about our budget process, our general fund expenditures and revenues. Just some different graphs that you can look through and make some comparisons about. This will be on our website as well for the community to take a look at. I just thought it was a comprehensive look at some of the finances in the district.
Great. Thank you. I like the booklet. It's nice.
Will it be given to the members of the growth task force or facilities task force?
Components of it definitely will be available to them. We have a data book that we're compiling, okay. So some of these components will definitely be.
They'll probably have more information than this than we might have. Yeah.
But I thought it would be a nice basic information than trying to look through our audit or anything like that. This would
look nice.
A nice complement to our budget.
Okay.
So I'd like to thank my staff. They really did a lot of work and research and to get this information put together. So
you could have made our picture a little smaller. It's kind of big.
That's right.
Okay, do I have to, we have to approve the budget. Okay. Do I have a motion to approve the 2016-17 budget?
So moved.
By Todd, second?
Second.
By Chad. Any other questions or discussion? Okay, seeing none, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That passes 6-0. Okay, and then Dr. Schaller, we have nothing for policy, or are you going
to start? Nothing for policy to review, but I just wanted to remind board members that we have been doing policy of the whole. We did the 200 series policies this fall, and as we start January, we're going to move into the 400 policies. We have a three-year, one of the commitments we made is to review all policies in a three-year cycle, so the 400 policies will come in draft form and some revisions next in January, so thank you.
All right, and then administrative reports.
Excellent. At Prior Lake Savage Area Schools, our mission is to educate all learners to reach their full potential as contributing and productive members of our ever-changing global community, and our collective work is focused on this achieving this mission. Tonight, I'd like to highlight just a couple of things that are happening to help us reach that end. The Facilities Task Force and Facilities Design Team, we have officially kicked off our community engagement process surrounding our long-term facilities planning. Our first meeting was held last Monday, and it was a joint meeting between the Facilities Task Force and the Design Team. TeamWorks led the group through the process and introduced them to the guiding change document that you as a board created and approved. We also spent time getting to know one another and hearing multiple perspectives of people in the room. It's a very diverse group with a wide variety of backgrounds.
We have business owners, a former superintendent, stay-at-home parents, engineers, realtors, bank managers, manufacturing and IT professionals, contractors, and many more. As you know, this group is also made up of staff, students, and includes residents who have a wide variety of thoughts, ideas, and opinions surrounding our schools and facility needs. The following are the key messages we developed as a group at the end of our meeting. We want great schools for our kids. We want different opinions. We want sustainability, communication, and transparency. We have different wants. We want our staff and community to understand our demographic changes and the process as representative of different voices, perspectives, and as representative of our community. The next meeting will take place on December 20th and will include introducing the task force to our data book and presentations surrounding our facilities, current enrollment, enrollment projections, finance information, and more. Also in the area of community engagement, I have scheduled my second focus group that will take place this Friday when I will meet with a group of retirees from Prior Lake and Savage. The purpose of these small group focus meetings is to share the latest news happening in the district, become better acquainted with members of our community, and most importantly, to listen to their perspectives and to learn from them about ideas for that continue to surround our district. And finally, Melanie already spoke to this, but I just wanted to highlight the second annual MNCAPS Parent and Student Information Nights coming up next month at Prior Lake High School, as well as Lakeville North and Lakeville South High Schools. Prior Lake High School meeting is January 4th at 6:30, where parents and students will learn about the MNCAPS opportunities that the students have in both the business and healthcare pathways. We've also created a new video, which will be launched at that time, which contains footage and interviews from our own students, staff, mentors, business, and healthcare professionals, and showcases the hands-on real-world learning that takes place every day at MNCAPS. Thank you.
All right. Any administrative reports tonight? No? Okay, board reports. Any board reports? Go ahead, Rich.
Melissa, Rich. Can I enlist some help going up to them and opening up the PDF there on the screen, upper left-hand corner? As 2 weekends ago, I got a chance to attend the NSBA Delegate Convention. Mm-hmm. And if you all remember back to September 26th, maybe not, mm-hmm. we voted on a resolution to bring forward at that time, and that one was not passed, but it was passed as an amended resolution. If you scroll down a little bit, Jeff, you can see that. So basically just taking out the reasoning, but the gist of the resolution is still there. And the MSB Delegate Convention is the largest grassroots lobbying effort in the state of Minnesota. So school board members from around the state come together and pass or talk about resolutions brought by those boards. And then those resolutions that are approved are then used by MSBA as a lobbying, as part of the main lobbying, or they're the main lobbying points. So I think this will fit in nicely, too, as we go to the new committee structure, that resolutions that that this district wants to bring forward, we can bring forward to the MSBA. So just wanted to update you on that.
Great, thank you.
Yep.
Melissa.
Yeah, I had the opportunity to do a couple different things. On November 19th, Saturday, I participated in the robotics mini competition, saw some builds and some opportunities. That was really wonderful. And then the SEE general meeting was last week, and Dr. Stalo and I attended that. For those of you who don't know, that is Schools for Equity in Education. And we discussed, along with the Commissioner of the Minnesota Department of Education, Dr. Brenda Casilius, the equalization funding issue between schools, so that schools in all the other areas have equal opportunity for funding. We discussed special education subsidies versus using the general fund formula, pros and cons. We have an effort going on to combine a little bit with AMSD, with the board that Rich participates in. And finally, we discussed the 2017 legislative platform with taxes there for public school children.
Okay, great. Student Council. Sorry.
Good evening, everyone. I'm lucky again tonight to not have a lot of homework to do. Our Student Council Exec Board has continued to meet with the administration monthly at addressing, trying to be that student voice to our administrators and bring forward issues. And so in the past month, two things stuck out with us. Many students expressed concern with the prevalence of testing, whether in a normal paper pencil test or in the new types of tests we're pushing, Socratic seminars and stuff like that. And the prevalence of those all coming on the same days, very prevalently on Friday. So we've started to work with administration, and they're moving forward in trying to create a school-wide testing calendar to try and separate out testing dates so that we don't have as many tests on the same day, or to limit it as much as we can, just to relieve the load on students as they're studying for their schoolwork. And then also, there have been some Wi-Fi issues going on around the school, and so we've opened up another Wi-Fi network, and it's definitely helped a lot of us get on online. Then again, it came up a little bit earlier, but we are opening up that third serving area, which a lot of people are excited about as students are starting to hear about it. The Laker Marketplace staff actually did a poll as we were leaving the lunchroom to help choose a name for it, so it was cool for a lot of students to be involved in naming that new serving area. The exec board and I are also working with the administration in planning a new type of school and student involvement week and student community week, which we have so far decided to dub it Survivor Week. There will be more details to come, but we're very, very excited about it, and we think it's going to bring a lot of students together. Then as well, our student council finances definitely do not look anything like yours, but we do have some decisions to make regarding money, and today we made two of those. Our council voted to partner with the Prior Lake High School staff and move $2,000 to a fund which will purchase holiday gifts for our students on free and reduced price lunch. So we'll be buying them gift cards for the holiday season. And then also the council voted to sponsor the 2017 Economics and Government class Day of Service. So that day they are going to be, every Econ and Government class will be working on making sandwiches for the homeless in Minneapolis. And so then the money we put towards that will go towards buying those supplies. So they can be doing that in that day and talking about the importance of service and helping your community. Then as I close it off, I just thought I'd leave us on a happy, heartwarming note. I was reminded of what a great school district and community we have today when I was followed on a social media account that followed 1,000 people today in Prior Lake High School that made it their goal that they are going to start recognizing students in our school for the kind things they do and for the good things they do in our community as leaders or helping other students. So I thought that was a very cool thing to see that they're going to start recognizing them.
Awesome. All right, thank you. Okay, next up is future events. December 22nd to January 2nd, 2017, no school, E through 12, it's winter break. January 3rd, 2017, classes resume, E through 12. January 9th, 2017, we'll have the organizational meeting of the school board here at the DSC at 6:30, followed by also on January 9th, the regular school board meeting at the DSC at 7. January 12th and 13th, just everyone note and should know that the MSBA's annual leadership conference is then. And then also one addition that's not on your thing is I wanted to make sure everyone knew that January 16th, we'll have the first meeting of the Community Engagement and Legislative Committee. We kind of had to set that date before we know what our committee assignments are. But I just wanted everyone to know that January 16th from 5 to 7, that committee will meet due to the fact that we have to get it going with the legislative. And when we meet our legislators in February, we have to have a platform. So this group has to start working on it relatively quick. So depending on who's on that committee, that will be the first meeting. With that, I think I'm looking for a motion to adjourn, and I would look over to this side of the table.
So moved.
By Dan. Second?
Second.
By Chad. All those in favor, say aye.
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 Opposed? That
aye.
Passes.
6-1?
Yeah.